Social media is becoming increasingly more important for business coaches and consultants as they try to build their brand online. It provides a new channel to promote your products and services through a pull marketing strategy. In this video, we will take you through the social media revolution and how social media has changed our methods of communication. I hope you enjoy the video. Next up, we have Chris Brogan, who consults and speaks professionally with Fortune 100 and 500 companies like Pepsi, General Motors, Microsoft, and more on the future of business communications and social software technologies. He is a New York Times bestselling co-author of Trust Agents and a featured monthly columnist at Entrepreneur Magazine. Chris's blog, chrisbrogan.com, is in the top 5 of the Advertising Age Power 150. He has over 11 years' experience in building online communities, social media, and related technologies.
Sawubona. It's a Zulu greeting. It means I see you. Since last year, I started everything I ever talk about with that word, because to me, it's the biggest difference in what this whole social media thing has done. We say hi most places, and we wave like this. This, by the way, is a medieval thing that means I don't have a sword or a dagger, and I'm not intending to harm you. Well, that's good. That's, you know, it's a good starting table stakes to any kind of greeting, but I'm not intending to kill you. But you can say hi even when you're not paying attention. You can say hi when there's so much other stuff on your mind. It's not that hard to do. Disney is well known for its incredible customer service and the way that their cast members act. And this one gentleman was a maintenance guy at the Polynesian, and the other thing Disney does is it's all very in theme. So if you're in Polynesian, you have to use Hawaiian type terms and whatnot. And I'm walking by this grumpy construction maintenance gentleman, and he's got his tool belt on, and it's very early in the morning. It's about 6 a.m. And I'm sure he's going to go get some kid who's stuck in an elevator or something awful like this. And he's just tromping by me, and I say, "Oh, good morning." He says, "Aloha." I had never heard that word said with such venom. But sawubona means I see you. The response is nihona, I am here. This is the difference in how communications have changed with this whole social media thing. But the first thing I always try to do is disavow everyone of the feeling that it's very gee whiz and that it's very crazy and that it's very foreign. And so I often say that 100 years ago, the conversation would have been about phone. I would have come in here and said, "Wow, you guys have to get phone. This thing is amazing. I have over 100 contacts on phone. I can call them anywhere. Oh, you know, and they can pick up. I can do business on the phone." And you'd be like, "Oh, pshaw, that's not what we do. We do business across the table. We shake hands." It's really the same thing. It really is. And I was trying to think in, people call it a revolution sometimes, and that's the wrong unit of measurement. Time and revolution is usually very fast, and then it's abrupt, and then new things happen. And then I thought, well, it's not an evolution, that's too slow. That's, you know, where we get opposable thumbs. I guess innovation is the closest timeline term I could think of, because phone was that 100 years ago. 100 years ago, we changed the way we did things with phone, and you know, we changed things like that when we went to rail systems in the country, and suddenly the world opened up with rails and all that. I think that these social media tools, though, are that next thing, and I think that the timeline between such innovations is getting smaller and smaller. Tom Peters likes to say that, you know, one of his favorite companies in the whole wide world is Netscape, because it was a finite company. It got in, it did what it had to do, left 5 years later, changed the whole world in the process. Not any one of us in the room doesn't use a browser for something. It's unavoidable to get onto the web in some form or another, but the company came and left. You know, they had nothing to do after that. When I get to the opportunity to talk to big companies and small companies and the mid-size, it's always the same thing. It's always this question of, what do I really do with this? I get it, everyone's telling me, gee whiz, it's cool. You can't watch news or see a bus go by or be in any hotel lobby in the world and not see that little Facebook F and that little Twitter T these days, right? They're like little glyphs that tell you we're cool. Really, we're just like you. Which, it's funny that they just put the logo and say that we're on Facebook, because that's like, instead of a website address, which you know where to go, they would just put a picture of the web, and you'd go, aha, and you don't know what to do. But the just FYI for all of your advertising and branding, should you just have we're on Facebook, that's not enough. Please give the URL. Little tactical tip, I'm sorry. More like a pet peeve. I went to see Fritz Henderson, who was the chairman of GM, and I went to see him the week before he was going to declare bankruptcy for General Motors. And the likelihood of this blogging nerd boy sitting across the table from the chairman of General Motors is I could also have piloted a spaceship last month. And what he said to me was telling, though. He said, I understand blogging, I don't do it because I don't have enough time. Everyone says that. We'll get to that. I get Twitter. I don't want to tweet, but I see what's going on and I talk to my people about it. What I really want to know is, what are people saying? What are they really saying about me? How do I really get a sense of what's going on? He goes, I pay all these marketers to give me surveys. Surveys are great, and that's what people do, right? Marketing surveys. He goes, all the surveys say I'm awesome. He didn't use the word awesome. They say I'm great, they say I'm doing wonderful things, but my CFO tells me not so much. A little issue here. And he goes, I want to know what they're really saying. And I said, oh, social media is great for that. Reputation management, listening. Listening is the new black. Instead of another tool that lets you chat, there's a whole set of tools that let you listen and hear what people are talking about and really understand what they're saying. It turns out we've invented this whole medium, this whole Facebook, Twitter, blogging world is a perfect medium for complaining. It's amazing. We can do so many great ways of griping and moaning about whatever we don't like. Everyone can raise their opinion. Go to Amazon, look at all the product reviews. It's fascinating. By the way, I've been told by my wife I didn't know there was such a thing as product reviews because I tend to buy things just because they look neat. And she goes, you know, there's all these other people that took all this effort to say that the thing stinks. And they don't look at it. You know, and it's kind of a funny detail, but it is a detail because hundreds of people can weigh in and the product company can't really say much about it. They don't have a voice in that race except to say, oh, no, no, you're using it wrong. And then you come off seeming a little defensive, right? Which, by the way, it's a great medium for complaining, which scares most companies into not wanting to use the tools. Oh, there are people will complain on our site. People will say bad things. That's why we can't have a blog, because if they say something negative in the comments, well, there goes the stock, right? People have complained for centuries, it turns out. I could probably go back and look at a cave painting of, you know, bad cow. It's not a, complaining was not invented by blogging, it turns out. I did some research. It happened before, you know. So I'm from Massachusetts and originally from Maine, and you may or may not know if you're a baseball person, which I'm not exactly, we went 86 years without a World Series title, the Red Sox. My grandfather lived and died yelling at a television as if it knew what was talking to him. He would always yell at the TV about how bad the pitching was or how he should have caught that. And all I kept thinking was, boy, would he be happy to be alive now, because now the TV, you know, he could YouTube that and, you know, send the videos to somebody and they could see them. It's really changed. But what do businesses do with all this? That's the other big question, right? As leaders, what do you do? How do you approve, deny, whatever? How does your IT team get comfortable with this? One of the things people panic about is that, oh my gosh, if we have Twitter, someone is going to tweet out the financials and destroy the whole company. Which, by the way, was the argument in the 90s when we thought Instant Messenger would rule the world. Oh God, we've created this window wherein which someone can IM their best friend our financials and we're all going to die. 25 years ago it was email. Oh no, someone's going to email out. See where we're going with this, it just doesn't end. Guess what, humans are stupid no matter the technology that equips them. You have to educate instead of worry about that. Does it go wrong? Yes, it absolutely goes wrong. I actually am friends with a gentleman from an agency who is in Memphis complaining about Memphis and saying what a horrible, stinky place Memphis is, which would be great, except that his biggest client was in Memphis, perhaps Federal Express, but maybe not, and and they read his tweets. And so they, you know, they sent him an email while he's in the airport saying, well, you don't have to come back, don't worry. Problem solved. So I gotta say, you know, there are, in old ancient maps, there was that here there be dragons experience. You know, don't go there, there's dragons. There are, you can die on the internet, it really happens. There's a big court case going on about somebody getting fired for something that they posted on Facebook. You'll see it, you'll read it. And by the way, there's a negative to every technology that ever existed, and this is no different. What do you do with it, though? There's three easy buckets. One is listening, like I've already talked about. Listening is one of the biggest, easiest things to do with it. It's also the least effort taken. Unless you're a healthcare company, and then don't, because you have to report on anything anyone says. And so if I just for fun tweet, why I always think of Viagra, I don't know. I took Viagra and hair shot out of my body. Then they actually have to go and, you know, even if it's just a joke, they have to go and research this, and it's like 16-page document every time someone tweets. So I tell healthcare companies, don't listen. connecting though with people, connecting, it's now a two-way street. For the first time ever, if you think of your website as the nicest shop that the world ever built, you know, it's in the perfect location. Michael said, you know, you think the best real estate is in Abu Dhabi or anywhere else, the best real estate in the world is on the web. I don't disagree. Huffington Post, what was it, $325 million? That's a pretty decent real estate deal. She took in maybe 10 and made 325. I'll take that. But if you think of your website as the best shop in the world, this social media tools make you the best shopkeeper in the world. Because the biggest difference is you can step out of your store onto the sidewalk with social media. You can talk to people at events with social media. My being here comes from me knowing Leo for a few years, who works at Vistage, via the social web, never met in person. It's a serendipitous experience, these new tools. And I know as a serendipity as a business competency is really low in the universe. I admit that, I understand that. No one's business plan says, over here we'll do serendipitous things. Can you imagine trying to sell that through, or like, you know, you're looking for a merger or a sale and they're like looking at your plans and your run book and they're saying, oh, it's a serendipity bit. Yeah. Oh, well that's everything. Let me tell you, I've had conversations not unlike that, to be really honest. But that's really is the magic in that old silk hat. I mean, the kinds of people you end up connecting with on these social networks that end up being very useful to their business. I had a similar experience, a whole different game, the UPS store, and suddenly UPS and I are doing business. General Motors, the reason I got to meet Fritz Henderson was from this very tweet, one tweet. Does it make me an old man if I think the Cadillac CTX looks sexy?
Yes.
That was it. 220 people responded to my tweet. 218 said, no, that's a really cool car. Two people said, yeah, you're an old man. Like all things in life, I thought more about the two people that said I was an old man. General Motors, isn't that true though? You get 100 nice things said about you, the two things someone said mean, you're like, am I a jerk? I really am. Social media amplifies this like no one else's business. The world's second most famous rapper, Eminem, said he couldn't possibly get on things like Twitter. He would lose his mind reading about people complaining about him. So believe me, that's human nature. So that tweet led to me meeting General Motors to hang out with Fritz Henderson, to test drive the new Camaro before it ever came out, to get in their OnStar program with their Escalade, and they have this thing inside of OnStar that they can stop your car at a distance, like if the cops are chasing you, which I didn't know. Which it turns out I'm in an OnStar equipped vehicle, I just thought of this. So they let me test that. It was just this whole experience, and it wasn't because I have some prominence or anything like that. It was because it was an opportunity to tell a story from the human side. Storytelling, as we know, is the best way to do business, right? It's the best way to get people interested. It's the best way to excite them. No one wants features. They want benefits. Beyond wanting benefits, your customers and buyers want to be the hero in their own world. If you're equipping them to be the hero in their own world, this is the biggest business win that you can have, right? That's Apple forever gets accolades. But what Apple really does is everyone in the room who has an iPhone feels hip. Everyone in the room who has an iPhone can do more business than the person in the room who has a CrackBerry. And I tell you, you all have them here. I've never seen a Research in Motion is alive and well in the Milken Institute. I do need to tell you that outside of these walls, that is not true anymore. People of Earth, I am from another planet, and there are no more Blackberries. I have an Android phone I'm trying to fish around and find, but I hid it so that I wouldn't make that tit-tit-tit-tit sound. Android has shot past Apple as a platform. And so you can't keep up with the tools, you really can't keep up with the players, and that's another thing people ask me all the time is, to the what's around the corner question, everyone's wondering what kills Facebook. Well, we don't know, because a whole bunch of you in the room probably still secretly have an @AOL.com address laying around. So, but boy, AOL forever, not so much. Perhaps one of the scariest rebranding things I ever saw was that new campaign where it's just a bunch of white letters and Arial bold with a fish behind it or something. So anyway, inside AOL joke, but they took their brand that everyone knew and threw it away and just put three letters up. We would have thought MySpace in 2007, because boy was that the rage. Believe me, they still think that. I talk trash about them all the time and they're like, no, we're really relevant. And I said, the comedians and escort services, evidently. I went back in, and that's all I saw in my mind. Comedians trying to tell me to show up at their gig. Facebook's a little trickier. 620 million users on Facebook, that's 1 in 11 humans on the planet.
Wow.
Nutty, right? 620 million. Most of the growth in Facebook is at ages 31 to 60. Most of them women. By the way, it's not a young kids thing. Kids are hiding from Facebook as fast as they can. They're not. They haven't told me where they're going. They don't want you to go there either. If you friend your mom, it's because you're not really using that account. Just FYI. Because I mean, the one feature Facebook has that, you know, I think a lot of people would pay a lot of money, especially Michael Phelps, is the was tagged in a photo by. Thing where someone else can put up a horribly looking photo of you or a really inopportune photo of you and it shoots right up onto your wall so everybody you know can see it. I think Michael Phelps would have paid $7 million to eliminate that feature. Bob Iger, you know, in this kind of conference it doesn't feel as much like a name drop, but I was hanging out with Bob Iger from Disney aboard the Disney Dream, and you know, we're talking social media, and he says, you know, we have 100 million fans on Facebook. So I was thinking about that. He has 626 million users total. He has 1 in 6 members like some Disney product. That's huge. Some Disney product, I mean, and by the way, that number is a little liberal, I have to say, because that number is, you know, like liked the Lion King DVD set and things like that. That's included in there. So. You could like a lot of DVDs if you spent some time on Facebook thinking that was useful to you somehow. I don't really know what the Lion King DVD set says to you in your news stream. Like, I don't really understand the news value of liking a DVD, but maybe someone does. What do you do with these things? So Facebook, the thing you do the most is you have community experiences there. It's a community management type tool. It's an opportunity for, you know, Vistage is a wonderful sort of closed environment that allows you to speak with members and speak freely and talk about really important things that matter to you in a way that you feel comfortable and safe and talking to people that are vetted experts that you trust and understand. That's a very important thing. Facebook is a lot more like the commons. Facebook is sort of like the reception area before something like a Vistage. So a Facebook page out there is where you allow the sort of common person to come in and just inquire a little bit and, hey, what's going on here? And it lets you spit out your news. That's where the people are right now. Again, to the around the corner question, which is a terrifying question, I don't know where they're going to go. If I did, I'd be wealthy because it would be an amazing thing. But what I think, if I had to posit where people go, it gets even more disjointed. See, what we look for as people is we look for some sense of organization. If Raphael does too. The water bottle was down here at first. He realized it could tip over, so he put it up here. It was kind of a little crooked. He turned it so that the logo faced. And squared it. This is human behavior. We do this. You're not OCD. It's okay. I do that. Are you? See, well, I am too. That's why I watched you do it. Because I was thinking in my OCD head, what's he doing with my water? Is my water going to be there? Can I have my water? You know, don't ever ask me to borrow a pen. The whole time it's out of my purse, I'm thinking the pen. This is social media, FYI. This is what social media does. Only I can't always be in Beverly Hills as much as I might want. And it's like hamburger helper for relationships. You can be somewhere else and keep the stuff going. You know, you can extend out. We're in a conference full of world leaders talking about huge things. And I see a bunch of people writing into paper notebooks and not, you know, keep writing. In these conference sessions. And all I'm thinking is, if you tweet this, if you share this out with the world, then you get the opinions of everyone who couldn't afford to make it, who had another opinion, who had something else going on. You can extend and spread conversation beyond your boundaries. Now, there's a huge thing with social media, top down, bottom up, you know, which one is which, right? First off, Craig Newmark, who founded Craigslist. Remember them? They destroyed newspapers. Oh, crap, we took away their financial model. Just don't let me forget Craig Newmark, but I just have a quick side note. So I run a bunch of marketing conferences. I put an adult film star on my stage, and the reason I did was because I said, you know what problem this person has in common with the newspaper industry? They're both down 89% on revenue. because other people give away content for free that they have to charge for. Porn's a tough business, I've got to tell you. It's down, and you know, those poor people, they're scrambling for other jobs. Adult film star and Target employee. Well, it's the same with newspaper people, right? So anyway, just a FYI data set. Craig Newmark from Craigslist said 67% of social media initiatives inside of corporations are guerrilla maneuvers. Meaning some one smart cookie said, we're gonna do this social media thing, and everyone else had to scramble. Real life example, Frank Eliason at Comcast. Comcast lives and dies by its customer service rating scores. They have very low and dismal customer service rating scores. And if you've ever lost your cable, which I know you never have, or if you've ever lost your internet and have you rebooted your computer, you know what it's like. So Mike Arrington, who runs TechCrunch, which is one of the preeminent blogs on technology, 2 million daily readers, calls Comcast because his system is down, which means his view of the world is down, his media empire is on hold until he gets it turned up. He calls, he complains, he doesn't get anything. In fact, it takes him like 65 minutes to get through the phone tree, and he still gets nothing, and he just gets frustrated. And what bloggers do, what did I tell you earlier? We complain. So he writes a blog about how Comcast stinks or whatever. This goes out to 2 million readers, good customer service, you know, good PR value. Nothing happens there either. No blog, no commenter comes on and says, oh, I'm from Comcast, I'm here to help. He tweets it, complaining on Twitter, I wish Comcast would just listen to me. This guy, Frank Eliason, who's just a customer service guy, like a manager of customer service, but not a director, sees it because he's on Twitter with a handle, Comcast Cares, and he responds, oh, I'm so sorry you're having trouble. How can I call you? Where do I reach you? What can I do? He rolls trucks within 2 hours of that conversation. The whole thing is fixed. It gets the most press Comcast has ever had in its life, positive press that Comcast has ever had in its life, and it becomes a thing. He goes from... The senior team decides they're going to fire him, clearly, because that's a stupid move. I can't believe he was using Twitter. No one even gave him the permission to do that. I can't believe he fixed that guy's problem and got us so many front page stories and news coverage, and CNN has him on TV. Slow day. That was pre Bin Laden. being caught, that is. Suddenly now, Frank went from that to 14 employees, and they made it a whole way of life. And to this day, it's really hard to get a business handled on Comcast via their website. I wanted to just change my business address, and I couldn't figure out how to do it. Couldn't even log in. It was just a miserable mess. One tweet, it's all fixed. This is how the world has changed. Customer service has changed this way. Communications has changed this way. PR has changed this way. Marketing has changed dramatically.
We have come up with 3 social media tools for you to become familiar with before you come to Studio 6 training. With more than 90 million professionals and one new person joining every second, LinkedIn is a vital resource in the small business community. Blogs are a great way to show that you're an expert on a subject. Take a look at our Executive Street blog to see how our members, staff, and the CEO community display their expertise in multiple facets of business. If you type in CEO Coach San Diego in Google, you'll notice that Vistage comes up on the top of the Google local search. By setting up a place page on Google, you are more likely to drive traffic to your website. See you at Studio 6 Training.